This is Software Engineering Radio, the podcast for professional developers on the web at se-radio.net. SE Radio is brought to you by the IEEE Computer Society and by IEEE Software Magazine, online at computer.org/software.
Welcome to Software Engineering Radio. I'm your host, Akshay Manchale. My guest today is Adar Leiber-Dembo. Adar is an Apache Kudu committer, PMC member, and now PMC chair. Adar has been working at Cloudera for the past 8 years, the first three of which were spent working on Cloudera Manager and recent five on Kudu. Adar worked on virtual device emulation and Linux drivers at VMware for 5 years. Adar holds a BS in computer science from Stanford University. Adar, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
It's great to have you here. We're going to talk about Apache Kudu today, which is fast analytics and fast data. We'll start off with some basics and motivations behind Kudu, understand more about Kudu, its features and capabilities, and later move on to some details under the hood. Okay, so quoting from the website, Apache Kudu completes Hadoop storage layer to enable fast analytics on fast data. So can you walk us through what Hadoop and Hadoop storage layer is?
Yeah, sure, I'd be happy to. Let's sort of set the scene. I think Hadoop was originally created at Yahoo back in sort of 2006 to 2008 range. And what it consisted of at the time was a distributed file system modeled after Google's GFS and a distributed processing framework called MapReduce, which was kind of an innovative way of chopping up and distributing a lot of data tasks without having to worry too much about the reliability and availability of those tasks. So the trade-off is you constrain your programming, and in doing so, you realize these benefits in availability and reliability. So people were using these two tools in concert to really handle the influx of very large data sets that were changing rapidly, were arriving quickly, and sometimes either lacked structure or the structure wasn't really realized until after the fact, until there was a real business need for it. And so the tools to process this data evolved over time. So in the beginning, there was just MapReduce, and folks would have to write some Java code to build a mapper class and a reducer class that would then process the data. But inevitably, people wanted to do something that was more SQL-like, especially as more and more business analysts got involved. They wanted to bring SQL to bear on these data sets. And so there was a lot of thinking into how we can do that. One of the first projects that got off the ground, I think originally at Facebook, was Hive, Apache Hive. And Hive basically took SQL queries originally and converted them into MapReduce jobs. And so this was, at the time, a somewhat rudimentary way to implement SQL on top of Hadoop. And here we're really talking about processing the data that's in HDFS and using MapReduce to do so. The downside to using Hive was that there was a pretty high cost in latency at startup time. And there were various costs along the way as you transitioned from one MapReduce job to the other. So there was a lot more thought that went into how we can improve that. And eventually you started to see the creation of dedicated SQL engines that operated directly on top of HDFS and did not use MapReduce at all. So I currently work at Cloudera, and back in 2012, Cloudera launched a project, an open source project called Impala, sort of designed to be very low latency and high throughput. So I would say that's sort of where Kudu got its start, in a sense, like against this backdrop of kind of data warehousing, analytics, and SQL.
So there's a whole ecosystem of projects that are built on top of HDFS. I see HBase, I see Hive, you mentioned Impala. So where does Kudu fit into this picture? What is lacking in what is out there already, and what does Kudu bring in to this ecosystem?
So let's go back to sort of the SQL context, because I think that's kind of the most instructive way to think about Kudu. If you wanted to do some kind of analytics in the Hadoop ecosystem, and especially if you were a Cloudera customer at the time, you were either doing analytics directly against HDFS, or you were relying on something like HBase. So for those of you who aren't familiar, HBase is a distributed database that's built on top of HDFS. It's modeled after Google's Bigtable system. And so each of these systems presented its own set of trade-offs. So with HDFS, in order to achieve the scale that it achieves, doesn't allow for full POSIX file system semantics. You can't take a random file and just open it and start overwriting data inside it. You can only append to existing files. And like I said, that allows HDFS to achieve its scale, but it makes creating a database somewhat more challenging. All you can do is append data, everything becomes perhaps more log structured, and there are many more constraints on how you do your work. So if you were working with HDFS and you were reading and writing data from HDFS, you had this great sequential throughput and ability to process files sequentially. What you lacked was the ability to mutate data. You basically had to rewrite entire sections of data in order to mutate, let's say, even one SQL row inside them. And you also lacked the ability to efficiently randomly read within your data set. So HBase tries to remedy that. HBase basically builds a different kind of abstraction on top of HDFS, and that abstraction enables efficient random reads and random writes. So that can be very useful for those kinds of use cases. The problem is there are often applications that need both of these. There are applications that perhaps need good sequential throughput as well as their odd random access. Or maybe there are applications that are predominantly sequential, but they need the ability to mutate data every now and then. And so there really wasn't a solution that offered both of these. Applications that needed both, their operators would often have to engineer complex architectures, typically called Lambda architectures, that would basically marry the benefits of batch and streaming together. But operating those things was a challenge because you had to stitch together a variety of different systems. So this is the sort of the problem space that I think originated the Kudu vision.
Okay, something I want to just try to understand a little better is HDFS. Can you just give a brief overview of what that looks like? Is it just a distributed file system? Is it a blob storage? Can you give some overview of that?
Yeah, so HDFS basically is a large distributed application, and it borrows extensively from distributed systems design, I would say. One of the important things that HDFS does is it separates metadata from data. The idea is that metadata is often much smaller than data for many use cases, especially in the big data ecosystem. And so there is a single process called the name node, which stores all metadata in memory because metadata is relatively small. And because it's in memory, it can serve up that metadata efficiently and it can make changes efficiently. Meanwhile, the data is modeled as these large blocks, often 64 megabytes or 128 megabytes in size. And these blocks are distributed across a tier of data storing processes called data nodes. And so by doing the separation of metadata and data, you can kind of apply different properties and different designs to managing and storing of each. So under the hood, HDFS guarantees availability for blocks by replicating them three times. So if you are a client and you want to write a new file, the file is broken up into a series of blocks. And as I said, because the blocks are as large as they are, there's sort of the assumption that the files themselves are quite large, which makes sense in the big data ecosystem. And so those blocks are then distributed across all the different data nodes that exist. Clients, if I remember correctly, will write to one data node, and then that data node will pipeline to additional data nodes. And only once there are three blocks that are written will the client be told that, hey, your block was written successfully. It's now made durable across this distributed file system.
So Kudu is built on top of HDFS. From a user perspective, how does one go about storing data in Kudu? Is it like a relational database system where I have a table and a set of columns and I can insert into it?
So just to correct one quick misconception, Kudu is actually not built on HDFS. It's built directly on local file systems. And that's a conscious trade-off that we made kind of early on in the project. I can talk in some more detail about that. But to answer your question, Kudu exposes an abstraction that's, I think, pretty familiar to folks who use existing SQL systems. Existing databases, really. So data is structured in the form of tables. Tables are partitioned to achieve scale. A table has a schema, and the schema dictates a distinct and finite set of columns. Each column has a specific type. Each column may have additional metadata associated with it, like a default value if one is necessary, nullability, which is sometimes necessary. In addition to the schema, you have to define a primary key for the table. And the primary key is very important because not only does it determine the uniqueness of any given row, but it also affects the sort order of the data once it reaches disk. So the primary key has an index within it, and it affects query performance in a very big way. And so people who use Kudu have to be cognizant of how to build their primary key and how to do partitioning in a way that's optimal for their workload. But basically, if you take, you know, the primary key, if you take the schema, you take the types, put them all together, this is starting to sound more and more like a standard, I don't know, MySQL database. I mean, there are obviously differences in the feature set, but I guess what I'm trying to say is I want to draw a distinction between the data model that Kudu uses and many of the NoSQL databases that came before that were more semi-structured and didn't quite look and feel as similar to a traditional database as Kudu does.
Okay, so what's different about Kudu compared to a traditional database?
So I would say the main difference is traditional databases typically target high transaction throughput. They're usually intended for what we call online transaction processing or OLTP workloads. Kudu is intended more for analytics, for OLAP, online analytics processing. And you see that through and through in its design. So one thing we haven't mentioned yet is that Kudu stores its data in a columnar layout on disk. And that's really great for analytics workloads, where oftentimes you're interested in maybe a handful of columns out of perhaps hundreds. So storing the entirety of a column or big chunks of a column in one file means that you can really minimize, say, the number of files that you need to do I/O on to satisfy a particular query. So that's, I think, one major distinction is that, you know, Kudu does not target the kind of transactional workloads that traditional databases do. Another is that Kudu is really optimized for analytics in the sense of kind of high throughput across many, many, many rows. And I would say that most traditional databases are typically optimized, again, because of their OLTP nature, they're sort of optimized for accessing one row, which maybe represents an entirety of a user record in some system. And Kudu is just not built that way.
Is it possible to just update data?
Whenever? Yeah, absolutely. I mentioned earlier on that one of the drawbacks of using HDFS was its lack of mutability in existing data. And that's one of the selling points of Kudu, that you can take a primary key belonging to a row and update a handful of columns, update, you know, all the columns, whatever you want. And you can also delete that row by primary key. And that's also a feature that I think makes Kudu resemble a traditional database more than, say, a NoSQL database.
On the website, Kudu says it's fast analytics on fast data. So when you say fast data, is it in terms of how fast you are with ingestion? Is it close to, say, real-time systems? Or is it just fast ingestion that's available for analytics?
That's a good question. One of the main selling points of Kudu is that when you are ingesting the data, it's made available for querying immediately. In traditional systems, especially if you were following one of these purported Lambda architectures, you might be accumulating data through some streaming system and then periodically dumping it into your analytics system. And so if your goal was to query that data, well, there was some sort of lag time between when the data arrived in the first system and when it was made available in analytics, typically on the order of, sort of depending on the stream of data and how much data we're talking about, but typically on the order of maybe a minute or an hour. And in some use cases, that can be the difference between useful data and not useful data. So if you're building, let's say, a fraud detection system, you know, you often want to know about the activity in the system as quickly as possible to make decisions about fraudulent transactions. And so Kudu definitely enables that. So the moment you write data into Kudu, the moment it's replicated within Kudu, Kudu will immediately serve it up for queries. That's kind of why we'd like to think about it in terms of fast data, because the data arrives quickly and it can be analyzed immediately. The other angle of fast data that we'd like to talk about is fast changing data. So Kudu, like traditional databases, will support an alter schema operation. So if your data changes in some way, if the structure of the data changes in some way, let's say you added a new column or removed a column or done something like that, Kudu supports that very efficiently.
One thing that you mentioned is that you can partition your data in a Kudu cluster. So can you give us some more details about that?
Kudu achieves the scale that it does by taking the table and sharding it. Otherwise, we would have pretty much all the data hosted on one system and we would bottleneck at the resource constraints of that system. So Kudu supports pretty flexible kinds of sharding, and we call that partitioning. We support both hash-based partitioning as well as range partitioning. And many of our more successful deployments actually combine the two of them, as you'll see. So let's start with range partitioning because I think it's a little bit simpler. When you create a table, you can define a set of columns that will comprise your range partition key. And then you are now on the hook, the user's on the hook, for adding and removing range partitions. And so these range partitions can map to something like a time dimension. And so maybe you're going to add a range partition to represent every hour in the day so that you can stream new data with events, let's say, that are belonging to that hour into that new range partition. And then after a month's time, perhaps you're going to age out that data by dropping that range partition, or maybe by moving that range partition into colder storage if you want to keep it around. So range partitioning sort of supports both time series oriented data in that way, where the time dimension corresponds to the range partition key. And range partitioning also supports kind of categorical workloads. So if you wanted to model, let's say, sales of a particular product, and you had different sales categories, range partitioning can be used to do that. Maybe you have different geographical areas and you want to be able to add and remove them on the fly. You might do so by modeling that as new range partitions or the removal of existing range partitions. Going back to hash partitioning is typically used as a means of optimally taking advantage of all of the write throughput that's available on a cluster. So when you're ingesting new data, if we were just using range partitioning, then let's say all of the data corresponding to a particular time period would land in the same partition on the same tablet server. And again, we would be bottlenecked then by the resource capabilities of that tablet server. Hash partitioning allows us to define a hash key, and all the rows that are then ingested are hashed using that hash key. And typically that means they will wind up in a variety of different hash buckets. So what we'll usually recommend people do is, if you have a cluster of, say, 50 nodes, maybe you want to configure a table to hash to, let's say, 100 different buckets. So yeah, you're going to average perhaps two partitions per tablet server, but then in the future, you can also add additional tablet servers and rebalance your partitions. And thus doing so, you can take advantage of those resources as they come online. But bottom line is, you basically can hash the data in such a way that you can spray it across the cluster and take advantage of the resources of all the cluster nodes, rather than just, say, the one range partition you had defined earlier. So I think it's really important to take these two things together, right? So the most successful tables are the ones where they're hash partitioned in order to write efficiently, and they're range partitioned in order to query efficiently, and in order to migrate the data efficiently, whether it's to drop the data or delete the data. And we typically recommend people use both of those. By comparison, other systems may not support nearly as rich partitioning schemes. If I remember correctly, and it's been a while since I looked at this, so I could be fuzzy here. I think Cassandra supports hash partitioning, but I'm not sure it supports range partitioning. So offering both kind of gives our users a lot of flexibility.
So one thing you mentioned there was about a tablet server, and I noticed we haven't really talked about what Kudu looks like from an infrastructure perspective. So what composes a Kudu cluster? What's a tablet server? What other kinds of nodes exist in a Kudu cluster?
Yeah, that's a good question. We probably should have started with that. So in Kudu, like in HDFS, we separate metadata from data. And so data is partitioned, as we discussed, and those individual partitions in Kudu are called tablets. And so data is organized around these tablets, and there is a process called the tablet server, which is a Kudu process, kind of like the HDFS data node, whose sole responsibility is to host these tablets and to operate them. Separately, there's a Kudu master process, and that master process hosts a single tablet known as the master tablet. And all the Kudu metadata, the entire Kudu catalog, is stored within that master tablet. And modeling the metadata as a tablet in its own right is kind of interesting because it lets us basically apply the high availability and replication capabilities of the data tablets to the Kudu catalog itself. So in a typical deployment, you might have a variety of different tablet servers, depending on your workload, anywhere from 3 or 4 all the way up to hundreds, depending on, again, how much data you're dealing with. And you might typically have maybe 3, maybe 5 masters. And we can go into the details of why you'd use an odd number, but basically it's to achieve high availability.
Can you talk a little bit about the failure modes of a Kudu cluster? What happens if I lose a particular tablet server or one of the metadata servers?
The Kudu data, the Kudu tablets themselves, are replicated using a consensus protocol called Raft. And without getting into the details of exactly how Raft works, it basically ensures that for 3 given replicas, you can tolerate 1 failure. Or for 5 given replicas, you can tolerate 2 failures. Or for 7 replicas, you can tolerate 3 failures, et cetera, et cetera. And so the Kudu, a given Kudu tablet is going to be replicated across multiple tablet servers to achieve this. So typically, if a Kudu tablet fails, let's be more precise. If a Kudu replica fails, which is one instance of the tablet on one tablet server, within a handful of seconds, the other tablet servers will notice, and they will elect what's called a new Raft leader. And again, without getting into the details too much, it's important to note that for any given tablet, there's at any given time 1 leader replica, and the remaining replicas are what's called Raft follower replicas. And the leader plays an important role in that the leader is responsible for processing all incoming writes and replicating them to the other replicas. So it's very important that we detect the failure of a replica quickly, and we quickly elect a new leader to serve incoming writes. Reads can actually be serviced from any replica, and we can, later on, if we talk about consistency, we can go into more detail into how that works exactly. But the very first thing that happens, again, within about a second or two, the remaining replicas in a tablet will notice that one of the replicas has died, and if that replica was a leader, there will be an election, a very fast election to elect a new leader to handle incoming writes. Separately, if the master notices after about 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes, that that failure, that replica failure, is now looking more and more permanent, that is, that replica is not coming back, well, so this tablet is now kind of under-replicated. If we set it up to tolerate one failure, if another failure is incurred, we're kind of stuck. So the master will trigger an asynchronous re-replication. It will pick a different tablet server in the cluster and say, hey, you're going to participate in this tablet now. Please copy the existing replica state from one of the other replicas in the tablet. And when you're done, join the Raft group and start participating in Raft. So that process also happens transparently. We sort of refer to that as Kudu's self-healing capabilities. And once it's done, the under-replication has been addressed, and that tablet can now tolerate another failure. So we talked about data tablets, and as I mentioned earlier, because the catalog, the Kudu catalog, is implemented as a singleton master tablet, it works exactly the same way. And that's why I mentioned earlier that you might have three or five different masters, because you want to tolerate, let's say, the failure of a master or the failure of two masters and still recover from that.
Can you talk a little bit more about the consistency aspects of the cluster? If I write data and then I ask like four different nodes about what I've just inserted, can I see that? How does that work?
So why don't I start by talking about durability, since it affects consistency a little bit, and then we'll sort of move on to the Kudu consistency model. So like I mentioned, we use Raft for replication, and Raft is also the source of our durability. The way that Raft works, you may only respond to a client telling the client that the write that the client made has been made durable if a majority of replicas in Raft have accepted the write and have written them to their write-ahead log. So quick sidebar, every replica in Kudu, every tablet in Kudu has a write-ahead log, and that write-ahead log is used for this durability purpose. So if you were to imagine for a minute a client writing one row to a Kudu tablet, the client will find the leader, the client will send that write to the leader. The leader will then replicate that write to the followers, the follower replicas for that tablet. And the moment a majority of replicas come back, including the leader, and say, hey, we've made this write durable in our write-ahead log, that's when the leader can then respond to the client and say, hey, we've made your write durable. Now, one other thing to note is that there's a difference in Raft between making something durable by putting it in the write-ahead log and applying it to what's called the Raft state machine, which is to say actually making the write in memory, let's say, available so that if you did a query, you would see the result of the write. And so in Kudu, the way in which we address this distinction is we have a concept of timestamps that we associate with every write. And this sort of gets back to your question about consistency. So the idea is that when a write arrives at a leader, the leader picks a timestamp for it. And we can go into more detail into how that works precisely. But for the moment, let's say it picks an arbitrary timestamp that represents a point in time that's now or in the future. And then when that write is replicated across the replicas, those replicas will also note that timestamp. And so later when the client does a query, the client can specify a particular timestamp to use, and Kudu will ensure that all the writes up and to and including that timestamp will be part of the query. So Kudu internally has a multi-version concurrency control system to ensure that. Could talk some more about how that works exactly, but for now, just know that it's there, it exists. And so Kudu can serve writes at different points in time. And this is how you would have a client manage to read its own writes.
When it comes to time, I see that Kudu supports this notion of hybrid time. Is that the same as the timestamps that you are putting on rows and what the client queries with? Can you go into some detail about that?
In Kudu, unlike systems like HBase, the notion of time that is used for consistency is distinct from the notion of time that applications might use for their own workloads. So Kudu supports, just as a point of order, Kudu supports a timestamp type column to represent application time. So if you're ingesting events or something, and every event has a timestamp, you would model that as a distinct column in your schema. Separately, internally, Kudu has its own timestamp mechanism that it uses to assign to writes and to satisfy queries. And this system is known as hybrid time. In other systems, it's called something like hybrid logical clocks, but they all sort of fundamentally work the same way. It's an attempt to marry the ergonomics of physical time, of real time, with the consistency model and correctness model of logical time, which is a design that's often found in distributed systems.
Let's move on to the analytics side of Kudu. What kind of data analytics features do you have in Kudu? What's different from other systems? One thing that you mentioned was that Kudu is a column-based storage. So what's the advantage of that over, say, row-based storage systems?
Let's start with some design goals. Kudu desires to serve scans and point lookups. And when I say point lookups, I'm saying you've given us a specific primary key and we want to give you all the data or some of the data for that primary key as quickly as possible. Low latency and efficient analytical scans. Analytical scans here refers to basically doing queries that might project a handful of columns out of perhaps the hundreds that are in your data set with a variety of different predicates on specific columns, perhaps part of the primary key, perhaps not. So the end result is that a range of data is sent back to the client, but that range often corresponds to, like I said, just a handful of columns rather than the entirety of the columns in the table. Kudu was written in C++ in part to satisfy all of our low latency requirements. We had our initial engineers, many of them worked on HBase and on HDFS for long periods of time. Those systems are written in Java, and Java is a great programming language for implementing distributed systems. One of the challenges is in dealing with garbage collection. It can be sometimes difficult to establish exactly how long the garbage collector is going to run, and depending on how long it runs, it can really affect the latency of a query. And not just the average query, but more specifically, say the 99th percentile query. We call these tail latencies. And one of the design goals for Kudu was to have very consistent latencies across the board, including tail latencies, to make it easier for people to build applications on top of it. So going back to your question, we want to support point lookups quickly and efficiently. We want the average point lookup time to be low. We want the 99th percentile to be low. And we also want to support efficient analytical queries. So we employ a variety of different techniques to do this. Number one is in the predicate system that we use, we push down those predicates as far as they will go. So clients do not evaluate predicates. Instead, clients send predicates to the servers, and the servers evaluate predicates. The servers will further push the predicate evaluation down into when I/O is actually performed. So at the time that we load data from the columnar files, we might do the predicate evaluation then, rather than at the time that we merge all the data in memory. And in doing so, we can avoid some unnecessary memory copies if the predicates happen to be very selective. Furthermore, Kudu columns, we haven't talked about this, and we can talk about this in more detail, but Kudu columnar data is compressed and encoded. And depending on the particular workload, the particular data, we have a variety of different encodings and compression schemes. So one of the benefits of pushing predicate evaluation as far down as it will go is we can actually, rather than reading the data from disk and decoding it and decompressing it, we can actually apply the encodings and compressions to the predicate values and then do the predicate evaluation directly against encoded and compressed data on disk. So we still have to read the data from disk, but we don't need to decompress it. We don't need to decode it. And in doing so, we become more CPU efficient. So the big win there is pushing the predicate evaluation as far down as it will go. Another big win is in the partitioning itself. So oftentimes, if you've done something like range partitioned across time, your queries may only need to touch a handful of range partitions, because maybe you're querying the data for the past day and you have 30 range partitions, each corresponding to a day in the month. So in your query, we can basically bypass 29 out of 30 tablets and only query against one tablet. So your query is way, way more efficient than if you had to distribute it across the entire Kudu cluster and do I/O everywhere. Another aspect of this is the primary key itself. So as I mentioned earlier, the primary key forms an index. And one of the benefits of having that index is if you have a predicate that consists of a prefix of the primary key, or perhaps the first column of the primary key, we can efficiently look up the first row of that query that you're looking for using that primary key index. We can start scanning and reading the data that you asked for. And then we can stop scanning once we've kind of crept out of that predicate value space, the predicate value that you asked for. So we can very quickly go to where we start the scan, scan exactly the data that you're looking for, the contiguous range of data that you're looking for, and then stop scanning. By comparison, if you didn't have that index, you would probably have to scan the entire tablet in order to keep the rows that you needed to keep and throw away the rows that you didn't need to keep. So that's yet another example of how our analytical scans this time are very efficient. And then going back to point lookups for a second, that primary key index serves to make point lookups incredibly efficient because we go exactly to the row that you're looking for and read its contents.
So one thing you mentioned, I want to see if I understand this correctly. If I have a predicate that says column X is greater than 15, you're able to encode that 15 in a way that's actually represented for column 1, so you don't have to look through the entire set of data. Is that one way to put it?
Yeah, that's exactly how I would describe it. So you encode the 15. You know that the 15 is for a particular column, column number 3. You know what the encoding for that column is because that's described statically in the schema. And so you encode the 15 using that columnar encoding and then compare it against the data that directly on disk. So this, I think, applies best, if I remember correctly, it applies best to dictionary encoding. So dictionary encoding is a form of encoding that we often use for our string columns. And the idea behind dictionary encoding is if you have relatively low cardinality columns, which is to say you have a column and it only has 10 or 15 distinct values, rather than storing those strings over and over and over, each string consuming some number of bytes, wouldn't it be better to instead construct a dictionary where you map from the 15 strings into, let's say, bit sequences? You know, if you only have, maybe 15 is a bad example, let's say 16. If you only have 16 strings, you only need 4 bits to represent all the combinations. And so you can basically replace every 30-byte string or 64-byte string or whatever with a 4-bit sequence, and you can achieve an amazing space savings in doing so, which is not only a good way to efficiently use your disk capacity, but also reduces the amount of I/O you need to do. So in this example, if we knew that a particular string had a dictionary mapping that mapped it to a particular bit sequence, we could then take the predicate value of that string, and we can convert it into that bit sequence, and then do the predicate evaluation using that bit sequence rather than the original string.
So this sort of encoding options are a part of the schema?
Yes. So at the time that you create the schema, you define a particular encoding and a particular compression scheme for each column. And if you don't want to, Kudu comes with some pretty reasonable defaults, depending on the type of column. And this is where I think columnar file layout really shines. Because in a traditional row-based layout, there wouldn't be these kinds of similarities across the runs of data as there would be in a columnar system. If you were, say, looking in isolation at a column of timestamps, you would probably observe that the timestamps kind of increment slowly, right? If you're inserting data and everything you insert corresponds to the wall clock time of now at the time of insertion, the data set is one where, you know, it goes from 1 to 2 to 3, maybe to 3 to 4 to 5, and these all represent, you know, units of time. So a differential encoding could be applied on top of that to very efficiently store those individual values rather than having to store those values in full.
So Kudu is a distributed system. Building distributed systems is hard. So is operating a distributed system. Something I saw on the website was that Kudu was built by people who have been operating other Hadoop and, you know, distributed file systems and stuff at Cloudera. So can you tell a little bit about what sort of things Kudu does to make it easier to operate?
I'm happy to talk about that. That's actually something I've worked on fairly extensively, so it's a kind of near and dear to my heart. So it's a lot easier to manage a single system, a single node system, than it is to manage a distributed system. It's much easier to kind of gain insight into what's happening if you are dealing with a single machine, because everything is very easy to correlate. You have, let's say, you have one clock on that machine, and you have a stream of events that are happening in the system, and all those events are correlated to that single clock. So relating things and understanding sequences of events that led to something happening is far easier. When you have multiple systems and you're working across an entire cluster, you have to deal with multiple clocks, which may be out of sync. So relating events across those systems is very challenging. And you're also dealing with just an n-fold increase in variability. Maybe you have one system, only one system out of 100 that for some reason is running some rogue I/O process that the system admin, you know, configured a year ago and forgot about. And that rogue I/O is causing certain queries on just that node to slow down. So not all queries are affected, but just, you know, 1% of all queries that happen to go to that node. And so figuring that stuff out is really, really challenging. So some of the things that we've done in Kudu to simplify that, and these are, you know, there's nothing particularly novel here. I think a lot of distributed systems do this sort of thing. So we expose a very broad set of metrics that describe how Kudu as a system is operating. Every node kind of publishes its own metrics. The idea being that if you have a metrics collector in your system, you can collect all of Kudu metrics and create nice graphs that kind of show how things are progressing in Kudu, and then perhaps build an alerting system on top of that to tell you when something goes awry. We publish some metrics that are simple counters that kind of describe the number of operations that Kudu has done. We also publish a variety of histograms, and those histograms kind of give you a sense for the average latency, let's say, of a particular operation versus the 99th or even 99.9th percentile of that operation. So that can give you a sense for when maybe tail latencies are being affected. And operators, you know, should use all these metrics to kind of get a sense for what's going on in their system, and again, to kind of alert if something goes wrong. We've adopted a tracing system from within Chromium, from the Google Chrome open source browser project Chromium, which helps us collect a trace on a particular node and identify all the different I/O that's happening on that node during that trace. So that can oftentimes be useful for debugging, I would say, simpler single node issues. We also, in addition to publishing the metrics for metrics collectors, we also dump, I believe it is, the last minute or so of metrics to disk in kind of a rotating fashion. So if you needed to do some after-the-fact debugging, you would have kind of the last minute or so of metrics to play around with. In that log that we keep, we also store thread stacks. So if there are some threads that are occupying a lot of CPU doing something they shouldn't be, you would notice them in those stack dumps. So you can get kind of live stack dumps by going to a Kudu server and asking for those, or you can investigate that log if you wanted to see something after the fact. So we have that Chromium tracing. We have the sort of standard metrics that we publish. We dump the metrics to a log. We have stack traces. We have the traditional, I would say, low-level application logging that most systems use. And so that can be collected and put somewhere in the system like Splunk or something else and analyzed. And let's see, what else do we have? We have inside Kudu itself, in the code base, we oftentimes annotate interesting functions with the trace macros. And what that lets us do is if we have, let's say, one RPC, a particular scan or something that happens to be slow, if it reaches a certain threshold, I think by default it's like a second, we will dump the trace output for that RPC. And so in the log, you will see something like, hey, this particular scan from this node to that node took longer than expected. Here are all the events that were correlated to that scan on this system. And you can look at them, and each event has the name of the event, as well as the corresponding amount of time that the event took. And so using that, you can kind of investigate and be like, oh, that's so weird. Why did reading from that particular file take longer than it should have? I'm going to go investigate that disk. Maybe something's wrong with that disk. So that can be another useful tool. So I think in totality, you know, we offer kind of a lot of different methods for getting observability, for achieving observability within Kudu. We've talked about adding some more stuff in the future. Some systems offer distributed tracing capabilities, which can be really powerful. That's not something we've been able to accomplish yet, though.
Can you give some examples about how these operational stuff that you have built has helped you in production?
One of the things we've noticed across our customer base, more often than not, people might have what I will call interesting networking configurations, where sometimes a switch in between multiple nodes can malfunction or can start doing interesting things to your traffic. We had a case that I worked on fairly recently where basically there were inter-server traffic between tablet servers. Once connections were established, once secure TLS-enabled connections were established, the nodes were able to communicate just fine with one another. But for some reason, every now and then, those connections would time out, and we didn't understand why. So Kudu at this customer site was deployed with a couple other systems, and all the systems were exhibiting this behavior in one way or another. One other system that I looked at was just saying, oh, I couldn't heartbeat to that server. One server was complaining it couldn't heartbeat to another server, without really any indication as to why. And that wasn't super helpful. Within Kudu, what we saw was a full trace in one server's log that said, I couldn't establish a secure connection to this other machine. And again, as I said earlier, we emit when something times out, when an RPC times out, we'll emit this detailed trace information that kind of describes all the steps and how long they all took. And so what I saw were all the steps in a TLS handshake, which establishes a secure connection between these two nodes. And one of the steps, one of them, happened to take, instead of, you know, the tens or hundreds of microseconds that it should have taken, it was taking like thousands of milliseconds. And so this was kind of a clue that perhaps there was a switch or some sort of system in the way that was maybe doing some deep packet inspection and had malfunctioned when it started to play around with TLS packets. So that wasn't a whole lot to go off of, but nevertheless, we told the customer about this, and that led them to eventually figure out that, yes, there actually was a switch configuration that was recently deployed that was then mangling TLS traffic in some way. And so they reverted that configuration, and the problem ceased to exist. So this was sort of an example where even having just a little bit more detail as to why something malfunctioned, a rare event, was able to give the customer enough information to go off of, do their own investigation, and solve the problem. Versus the other system I mentioned, which didn't give us very much detailed information, and its communication failure manifested as any other communication failure and didn't give us a whole lot to go off of.
That's pretty cool. I want to switch gears slightly and talk about integrations of Kudu with other systems in the Hadoop or HDFS ecosystem. I see that, you know, you can run MapReduce jobs, you can run Kudu as the underlying data store over Spark. Can you tell us a little bit about what these integrations are like?
Yeah, so we actually need to update that part of the website. As much as we like integrating with MapReduce, not many of our users use that anymore. But anyway, taking a step back, we do pride ourselves on supporting many, many different kinds of integration. And I think that's important to us because we are this kind of hybrid system that endeavors to be really good at scans and really good at point lookups. And because of that, we feel like Kudu can be applied to a lot of different kinds of workloads. Workloads that exhibit both of those properties, or workloads that perhaps exhibit one, but are thinking about maybe, you know, scans that are doing scans and then thinking about offering point lookups or vice versa. So we do try to be really good citizens and integrate with a lot of different systems. Many of our users use Spark, Apache Spark, and Apache Spark is kind of a newer, maybe it's not fair to call it newer anymore. Feels newer to me, but it's kind of another way of doing distributed computation, where unlike in MapReduce, you have to define these two classes in Java, a mapper class and a reducer class. Spark offers kind of a much richer and higher level framework for doing data transformations. So map and reduce are two primitives that Spark supports amongst many, many others. And so you define these pipelines in Spark using these primitives, and then Spark is responsible for materializing the data at every step of the way and ensuring that the right computation runs in the right order and ensuring reliability throughout. So a lot of people like to use Spark. There's even a SQL engine built on top of Spark called Spark SQL, which some of our users like to use. And we find at Cloudera, we find that many of our customers use Spark for ingesting. So Spark is very rich for the purpose of ingesting new data. There's a variant of Spark called Spark Streaming, which can be used to stream in data as it arrives, and many folks use that. Separately, on the query side, Kudu supports integration with Impala, which is that SQL engine I mentioned earlier. We also support integration with Apache Hive, with Presto, with Apache Drill. These are all kind of systems of the same nature. They're basically SQL engines that were built in the big data ecosystem and may not be super duper opinionated about storage, which makes them very easy to integrate with Kudu because that's what Kudu's bread and butter is. So many of our users use those systems, or they might use BI tools that are built on top of those systems.
When you say SQL engines, these are systems that support running a traditional SQL query?
Yes, although they are typically built to work against massively scalable storage systems like HDFS, or in a public cloud context, like Amazon's S3 or Microsoft Azure's ADLS, those kinds of systems. So yeah, I should probably clarify, when I say SQL engine, I mean in the big data context. So operating against massive data sets that may be changing, data sets that may have a high velocity of data being ingested to them at the same time, versus your traditional RDBMS kind of database.
So Kudu is an open source project. How can our listeners get involved in Kudu?
Kudu is an open source project. It's an Apache project. It's part of the Apache Software Foundation. So in addition to being open sourced and licensed under the Apache Software License, the project is community driven. So we have all sorts of members of the community who participate in the development of Kudu. Some of them work for Cloudera and many of them don't. So the best way to get involved is to, I would say, access kudu.apache.org. Go to that URL. That's Kudu's homepage. There you'll find all sorts of documentation on Kudu. You'll be able to download releases. And then within the community tab, if I remember correctly, We offer both some Slack channels if you want to do some real-time communication with Kudu developers, as well as a mailing lists if you'd like to send us some email. If you start using Kudu and you find bugs, we have a bug tracker that you can report those bugs in, and we're very happy to get more and more contributions.
Okay, I want to wrap up. Is there anything else that you would like to talk about Kudu or mention?
I like to think of myself as a distributed system developer through and through, and one of the things that I really enjoy about working on Kudu is its sort of hybrid nature, how it tries to achieve many, many different things. And while it may not be the perfect system for scans or the perfect system for row lookups, it is really good at all of those things. And that is made for a very interesting design and implementation of Kudu as a system itself, because you have to weigh a lot of different competing interests when making a change, and you have to consider a broad variety of users. And that's been very, very fulfilling for me. It's been very nice to kind of bridge these different communities and operate in this kind of larger space versus being just pigeonholed or narrowly focused on a particular set of use cases. So that's just something that appeals to me as a developer, as someone who kind of enthusiast about these systems. It's been really fascinating and fulfilling to work on Kudu.
All right. With that, we'd like to wrap up. Adar, it's been great having you on the show. Thanks for coming on the show and talking about Apache Kudu. This is Akshay Manchale for Software Engineering Radio. Thank you for listening.
Thanks for listening to SE Radio, an educational program brought to you by IEEE Software Magazine. For more about the podcast, including other episodes, visit our website at se-radio.net. To provide feedback, you can comment on each episode on the website or reach us on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, or through our Slack channel at seradio.slack.com. You can also email us at team@se-radio.net. This and all other episodes of SE Radio is licensed under Creative Commons License 2.5. Thanks for listening.